Hi everybody, this is Dr. A with a continued series on basics of the lab for systemic hematology. We're going to look at anemias. So anemia, you can define it in a couple of different ways. There's a functional definition, which is a decrease in the ability of blood to carry oxygen to the tissues. And then there's a clinical definition, which is a decrease in the RBC counts, the hemoglobin, and the hematocrit below the established normal values for healthy people of the same demographic population under similar environmental conditions. Anemia occurs when either there is red blood cell loss or red blood cell destruction, and that loss and or that destruction exceeds the maximum capacity of the red cell production in the bone marrow. So you're losing or destroying more that can be replaced, and so therefore there's a deficit there, and so you get anemia. It can also occur when there's an impairment in the bone marrow production of red cells, and this could be without the loss or the destruction, simply the bone marrow is having trouble putting red cells out. So an example with the impairment in the bone marrow production of red cells would be if there is a leukemia and all the white cells that have grown from the leukemia have crowded out the immature red cells, and they've been crowded out. They don't have enough nutrients, and so they're not able to turn out the red cells the way they're supposed to. An example for red blood cell loss is a GI loss, for example, a GI bleed. That, you know, if it's chronic, obviously, then the problem could be that the person is losing more blood in their GI system than the bone marrow can replenish. And a destruction one would be any of the hemolytic anemias where the red cells can be coated with antibodies, and then that causes them to be pulled from the circulation. So this is a visual representation of what normally normal blood would be. It would be half plasma and about half red cells with some white cells here in the middle. If a person has anemia, then you can see there's just not enough red cells and there's more plasma in relationship to the red cell. And so that would be evidenced by a low hematocrit. And here it looks like almost like half of what it would be normally. So maybe that's a hematocrit of, you know, 20 to 25%, depending on how you read it, not being super precise here. And then polycythemia is when there is more red cells than is normally anticipated or normally would happen. And so there's a video on polycythemia you can go see if you need to refresh on that. So anemia is not a disease in itself, but it is a symptom of an underlying disease process. So for example, in our case of a GI bleed, the anemia could be evidence of the GI bleed. You would have to do further testing, obviously, to detect a GI bleed, but somebody could be like having all the signs and symptoms like being tired, having heart palpitation, weakness, etc. They go to the doctor, they see there's anemia, they're like, oh, well, we need to investigate the cause, and then you would find the underlying cause. The signs and symptoms of anemia do depend on the severity of the anemia and the rapidity at which it develops. So an anemia that is really slow developing, or it's going to have really mild signs and symptoms, and it may take a while for the person to realize that something's off. Whereas an anemia where there is a sudden loss of blood, like in a trauma or a wreck, then they will very quickly have signs and symptoms because the body doesn't have time to adapt as fast. So the signs and symptoms of mild anemia are going to be weakness and fatigue. And there's usually not the pallor, so that's looking pale. And if somebody is has a dark skin tone, you can look inside the lips here and look at the membranes and mucous membranes to see. You can also like pull the eye down to see if that is pale. But in a mild anemia, you wouldn't have pallor. In a severe anemia, though, there is pallor. So there's paleness and pale mucous membranes. There's shortness of breath, there's tachycardia, which is a fast heart rate, and heart palpitations. The red cell indices can be used to classify the anemias based on the morphological differences in their red cells and what it looks like on the slides, because there are different causes of anemia. So we're going to look at a few of those. So the first one would be a microcytic anemia. where the red cell index of the MCV is greater than 100 femtoliters. And macrocytic anemia is a lowered hemoglobin value that's associated with abnormally large erythrocytes or red cells. This slide shows we have some normal sized red cells, but then you can see here some macrocytic ones, some large ones. The two most common causes of macrocytic anemias are vitamin B12 deficiency and folic acid deficiency. The lab test then, of course, is we're going to do a B12 and we're going to do a folate. Folate can be run on serum and on red cells, and you would expect those to be decreased with a macrocytic anemia. There was a test called Schilling's urinary excretion test. This test has been discontinued. It was a test that used radioactively labeled B12 and pancreatic enzymes and checked for absorption problems, but it's just no longer done anymore. You can also do a serum methylmalonate and a serum homocysteine. So methylmalonate combines with B12 to make coenzyme A, which is used in the Krebs cycle and energy production, and if there's not enough B12, the methylmalonate is going to be increased. And homocysteine is a breakdown product of B12 and folic acid, and believe it or not, you would think it would be decreased and deficiency, but no, it's increased. So high homocysteine levels are usually indicative of B12 and folic acid deficiency. Then there's the microcytic anemia, so the red cell index of the MCV is going to be less than 80 femtoliters. The definition is the microcytic anemia is an anemia associated with abnormally small erythrocytes with an increased area of central pallor. So you can see these red cells here are more pale in the middle, meaning they have less hemoglobin, and then some of them are just really tiny and oddly shaped. The most common microcytic anemia is caused by iron deficiency, so iron deficiency anemia or IDA. The lab test that would be run, it would indicate that are going to be the serum iron, the total iron binding capacity, the ferritin, and the transferrin receptor. You would expect the serum iron to be decreased and the ferritin to be decreased because the ferritin is the storage form of iron. So both of those would be decreased. The total iron binding capacity would be increased because your body has a higher ability to bind that iron in the blood because it's looking for it because there's not enough. So that binding capacity is going to be increased. And same thing with the transferrin receptor. The transferrin is a protein that ferries this iron, is going to be increased because there's less iron being transported and it's looking for more iron to transport. So that's going to be increased in all of these in microcytic anemia. Then you can also have normochromic normocytic anemia. So the MCV is normal in that type of anemia. And the most common causes of this type of anemia, where there's like really no changes in the red cell indices, are going to be acute blood loss. So patients who have suffered an acute hemorrhage and have a dramatic drop in their red cell count. For example, somebody gets stabbed in the femoral artery. That could cause an acute blood loss, right? Hemolytic anemias. Those are anemias where there is hemolysis. Hemolysis is the lysis or destruction of red cells. So they burst, and therefore they can't carry oxygen anymore, and if this occurs rapidly or excessively, you can get severe anemia. And then anemia of chronic disease is usually a mild to moderate anemia that often accompanies numerous infections, inflammatory traumatic diseases, or neoplastic diseases that last over 1 to 2 months. So chronic diseases that leads to anemia, basically. The lab tests that are relevant for those are the retic count. The retic count would be elevated, especially in the acute blood loss in the hemolytic anemias, with the bone marrows trying to churn out more of those red cells to replace the ones that are being lost or destroyed. The direct antiglobulin test is a test for antibodies coating the red cell. And you would expect it to be positive in a hemolytic anemia, but you would not expect it to be positive in acute blood loss or anemia of chronic diseases. And so the anemia of chronic diseases, you can see an increased retake count, again, as it's trying to maintain the proper amount of red cells also. All right, and that wraps it up for the anemias. Thank you for your attention.